Operation Uranus was not over, but it had already succeeded. It was the first time in the war that the Soviets had been able to penetrate sufficiently into the Axis operational depths. They had encircled the 6th Army, 5 corps, 21 German divisions, 2 Romanian divisions, and a bunch of combat support and other service units were now trapped in an ever-shrinking pocket. It had taken Paulus and Hott well over a month to capture roughly the same territory during the summer, but it had only taken the Soviets about 5 days to do the same during the winter. In other words, this was a stunning Soviet victory. Glantz estimates that the Axis had lost around 124,000 men by the 23rd of November 1942, with 90,000 of these losses being Romanian. German tank strength had fallen to 140 panzers and 30 assault guns, and almost all of the Romanian tanks were lost, meaning that the Axis only had about 170 armoured vehicles out of the 524 that they'd had before the battle. And the breakout dilemma still hung over the German command. Hitler thought that there was nothing the 6th Army could do except stand and fight, but the opinion of the commanders in the field had moved towards the idea of a breakout. At 18:45 hours, von Weich sent a message saying that the army couldn't be supplied by air, and that a rescue operation couldn't begin until the 10th of December at the earliest. Therefore, the only option was to launch a breakout, which he said would benefit the entire sector. But note, von Weich only came to this decision late on the 23rd of November. This was after the 6th Army was already surrounded. This was also the first time that he gave his recommendation to the High Command and Hitler. And we also have Paulus coming to this conclusion late on the 22nd, which is when he started planning a breakout, and then asking for freedom of action on the 23rd. So, any suggestion that a breakout could have occurred before this point is moot, because the generals themselves hadn't come to this conclusion until now. But not all of the generals were on board with the breakout idea. In the early afternoon on the 23rd of November 1942, Field Marshal Erich von Manstein arrived at von Weichs's headquarters and sent this message to Paulus. "I assume command of Army Group Don on the 26th of November. We will do all we can to get you out. In the meantime, it is imperative that 6th Army, while holding firm on the Volga and North Fronts in accordance with the Führer's orders, stands by with strong forces as soon as possible, in order to force a supply route towards the southwest, if necessary, at least temporarily." To be fair to Manstein, he hadn't yet had time to fully grasp the situation, but it does show that the immediate thought was to hold on, not to retreat. Manstein was one of the best generals in the German army, so his opinion had some weight to it. Manstein later claimed that he telephoned the 6th Army and informed them something on the lines of, "A breakout by 6th Army to the southwest was probably still possible even now. To leave the army at Stalingrad any longer constituted an extreme risk in view of the ammunition and fuel shortage. Nevertheless, since we considered that the best chance for an independent breakout had already been missed, it was preferable from the operational point of view at the present time to wait until the projected relief groups could come to the army's aid, always assuming that an adequate airlift could be counted upon. The latter factor, we emphasized, was absolutely decisive." I think the thing to note here is that Manstein, the greatest German general, believed that the 6th Army's best chance for a breakout had already been missed, and now they had to wait for the relief attempt. This means that Paulus only really had from midday on the 22nd to the 23rd of November to make an independent decision on whether to break out or not. And as we've discussed previously, a breakout before this point wasn't really an option. In other words, Paulus didn't ever have the chance to conduct an independent breakout, and his next opportunity would only come when Manstein's relief attempt was in full swing. Also, it's interesting that von Manstein was with von Weichs this day, but was coming to the opposite conclusion of him. He was also optimistic about the upcoming airlift and the relief operation. So, the generals were divided in their assessment of the problem at this early stage. Zeitzler received von Weichs's and Paulus's messages and presented them to Hitler when he arrived from Berchtesgaden at midnight. Hitler, though, was tired and put off the decision until the morning. Getting the wrong impression, Zeitzler telephoned Army Group B and told them that Hitler would authorize a withdrawal in the morning, which also suggests that the meeting between Hitler, Goering and Zeitzler didn't take place on the 23rd. Von Weichs informed Paulus, and the two waited for the green light. Paulus, though, was already preparing a breakout plan, called Operation Umbau, Operation Conversion. Glantz says it probably required a phased withdrawal of the units in the pocket first, before it could be launched, which was partly why they were retreating their corps across the Don. And it's within this context that General Seydlitz of 51st Army Corps decided to issue Order 118, designed to both withdraw the 94th Infantry Division from the northern blocking line and compel Paulus and the other generals in the pocket to break out. This was to happen just as the 3rd Motorized Division was being moved to the west. Well, his men destroyed the weapons and supplies they couldn't take with them, causing panic in the ranks. They then fell back in complete disorder, with the Soviet 66th Army in pursuit. Some of the Germans were caught and wiped out, Latyshenka fell, and at 1500 hours, the 99th Rifle Division reached Group Gorokhov at Rhenok. Gorokhov had crossed the Volga and taken up positions in the Rhenok area on the 28th of August, all the way back in episode 13, and had been isolated since about the 14th of October, episode 29. Well, Colonel Gorokhov and his men were finally liberated. After this disaster, the 94th Infantry Division sent out an order cancelling the retreat, telling the men to form a defensive line where they stood. Everyone breathed a sigh of relief, for everyone was certain that a withdrawal in such a rush would have meant disaster for all concerned. The 94th Infantry Division lost about 200 men and officers in this withdrawal, a serious blow to an already gutted division. The division now barely existed at all, with its regiments having been reduced to the strength of battalions. Worse, the Luftwaffe radioed the news of an unauthorized withdrawal directly to Hitler. On the morning of the 24th, therefore, Hitler decreed that there would be no more talk of retreats. He did allow their heavy weapons and equipment to move to the southern part of the pocket, and informed Paulus that two panzer divisions were being moved to the Kotelnikova area with the intention of linking up with the 6th Army, but otherwise the 6th Army would defend its current positions and await resupply by air. He also demanded a full report on how and why Seydlitz had issued his order in the first place.
Now, you would think that Hitler would punish Seydlitz for this. But what's interesting is that Hitler blamed Paulus for the retreat, not Seydlitz. And thinking that Seydlitz would offer fanatical resistance, Hitler decided to split the command of the pocket in two. In other words, the 6th Army was no longer a unified force, and Paulus no longer had total control of his army. The irony, of course, was that Hitler was giving command of the Northern Front to the guy who's just shown his willingness to disobey orders and withdraw from the Northern Front. But it appears that Hitler didn't realise this. Hitler suspected that Paulus had been behind this withdrawal, even though he wasn't, because Paulus had been asking for freedom of action and then suddenly allowed a withdrawal from the northern blocking line. Seydlitz had acted behind Paulus' back, but Hitler blamed Paulus, which confused historians for some time.
For some inexplicable reason, Paulus refused to tell Hitler that the man he trusted actually had defied him.
It does highlight the fact that the corps commanders could make their own decisions. We always hear about Paulus not having the guts to break out, but what about the generals beneath him? If breaking out was the right option, why didn't they all do what Seydlitz did? And why didn't Seydlitz continue to disobey orders and break out? In fact, Paulus himself highlights this contradiction when he sent Seydlitz the most sarcastic message of the entire Battle of Stalingrad.
Now that you have your own command, you can break out. Yeah, Seydlitz definitely got the message. I suppose there is nothing I can do but obey.
This just shows that it's not an easy decision to make. Seydlitz seems to have realised that he had messed up and decided to do as he was ordered. And to guarantee that Paulus couldn't conduct any more retreats, Hitler sent a liaison officer, Major Colistin von Zitzewitz, to Paulus's headquarters, allowing Hitler to both spy on Paulus but also have direct control of the army and prevent it from doing anything he didn't want it to do. So from now on, if Paulus started to prepare a breakout, Zitzewitz would inform Hitler, who would have time to react and stop him. Therefore, Paulus's hands were now tied, and the Sixth Army was tethered to their fate. In this sense, it may have been Seydlitz who doomed the Sixth Army. Of course, the Soviet command were also concerned about the Germans escaping the pocket. They therefore concluded that the best course of action was simply to destroy the surrounding force, which they estimated to be about 80,000 to 90,000 men strong. They believed that they could do this with relative ease, since they had several armies in the area and the Germans wouldn't be receiving supplies. And if their forces could aim for Gumrak, the pocket would collapse. The problem was that they had to guard against a possible relief attempt. They had to form an outer encirclement line, but because the bulk of their forces were concentrating on wiping out the 6th Army's pocket, they didn't have much to spare, so they aimed to destroy the pocket quickly before a relief attempt was made. Unfortunately, they had underestimated the number of men trapped in Stalingrad. The numbers are disputed as always, and the range does vary, but the likely numbers are 264,000 German men, not all combat troops of course, 20,000 Romanians, and as many as 60,000 Hiwis, making the total strength of the 6th Army 344,000 men. That said, some have calculated it slightly lower, at 310,000 men, and Manstein notes that it probably wasn't even 300,000 men because a lot of the wounded, the people on leave, and many of the rear service units were outside the pocket. But even so, the number was three times the 80,000 to 90,000 Soviet estimate. And as a result, the Soviet command's idea of a quick reduction of the Stalingrad pocket was instantly put in jeopardy. This was made worse because the Soviets had expected Operation Uranus to have been completed in about 3 days, not dragging on behind schedule as it was doing. They had outrun their logistics and they hadn't stockpiled enough to keep the offensive going for this long, so they were now beginning to run out of ammunition and supplies. This helps explain why their units were beginning to make fewer and fewer gains, as we're about to see.
Overnight, from the 23rd to the 24th of November 1942, General Stanescu surrendered the remaining forces of Group Lascar. As a result, 27,000 Romanians were captured, and the 63rd and 96th Rifle Divisions spent the day collecting prisoners. To the southeast, Yeremenko ordered his forces to attack the pocket, but apart from some minor gains, Shumilov's 64th Army barely did anything, and the 29th Rifle Division took heavy losses in its failed attempt to take Elki. Similarly, the 29th Motorized Division and the nearby Kampfgruppen held off multiple attacks made by Tolbukhin's and Trofanov's forces, preventing them from advancing northwards. And the only significant event in this area was that it was decided to merge the 5,000 men of the 20th Romanian Infantry Division into the 297th Infantry Division. Also, Volsky's 4th Mechanized Corps was transferred to the 21st Army and ordered to drive on Marianovka, and the 26th Tank Corps was transferred from 5th Tank Army, but hadn't yet fully crossed the Don River and so would be delayed. Kravchenko therefore moved his corps northeast, running into German resistance from multiple units including the 3rd Motorized Division and elements of the 14th Panzer Corps, the latter withdrawing across the Don. 16th and 24th Panzer Divisions held off the entire 3rd Guards Cavalry Corps, and Chistiakov had to wait for the rifle divisions of his army to catch up in order to lend support to the struggling horsemen. Still, the Soviets chased Strecker's 11th Army Corps as it withdrew towards the Don, with Batov urging his exhausted troops onwards, still hoping to encircle their enemy. But, despite advancing several kilometers, they had no chance of surrounding Strecker's units, as Galanin's 24th Army once again failed to break through the enemy's front. Nonetheless, Strecker's retreat was done in chaotic circumstances, and those falling back towards the river had few horses left, since most had been sent to the rear. So the Germans used half-starved Soviet prisoners of war to pull their wagons and equipment. Those prisoners who could not drag the carts as quickly as the Feldwebel wanted were shot on the spot. In this way, we were forced to pull the carts for 4 days, almost without rest.
At Akimovsky, German soldiers got into fights with each other in a race to get across the bridge first. The police unit in the area was unable to control the situation, and some fell to their doom through the ice of the Don River. Many of the wounded, or those who lost their footing, were trampled underfoot. Supply depots were put to the torch or plundered by the fleeing troops. But in this chaos, the 14th and 24th Panzer Divisions, plus two regiments of the 376th Infantry Division, withdrew over the Don.
Below the pocket, Shapkin drove the 81st and 61st Cavalry Divisions south, capturing several towns and stations as other units were brought up to reinforce them. To the east, the combined attacks coming from all different directions forced the Romanian 4th Infantry and 5th Cavalry Divisions to abandon Sadovoy. They, and other elements, fell back south on this day, with the plan being to withdraw west towards Kotelnikova starting the next day. In the Kalach area, Butkov's tank corps managed to reach the Don River, but was unable to overcome Group Adam's defences, mainly because he was concerned about guarding the flank of the 26th Tank Corps to his north, not advancing south. Further west, Rorts and Sion's divisions continued to fight in almost encirclement against the 8th Cavalry Corps that had some tank and rifle support, and what was left of the Romanian 1st Armoured Division recovered its composure to their south. Because the 346th Rifle Division, supported by the 216th Tank Brigade, drove into the western portion of the pocket, Rort recalled his anti-tank guns from Zion's division, leaving the Romanian infantry defenceless. They were quickly surrounded for a second time and forced to launch another breakout. This time, however, their luck ran out, and of the remaining 3,500 men, only 800 managed to get to friendly lines. Zion was also killed in the process. However, even with this sacrifice, 22nd Panzer Division was in a terrible position, and they would have to fall back. Luckily for the Germans though, the Soviet cavalrymen ran low on ammunition, halting their attack, and this gave the Germans and Romanians time to form two Kampfgruppen and prepare to retreat over the Kurtlat River that night. To the northwest, 1st Guards Army launched an attack against the Romanian 1st Army Corps in an attempt to surround and destroy them. While they did take some bridgeheads over the Krivaya River, they were hit by heavy fire and barely went anywhere. And Hollett's two divisions engaged with the Soviets in the area, shoring up the Romanian flank. So, zooming out, we can now see the full situation at the end of the 24th of November 1942. The pocket was shrinking, and huge areas of the map still didn't have a front line, although both sides were rushing to plug these gaps.
In the pocket, the 6th Army had to cut rations by 50% on the 24th in an attempt to preserve the stock of food they had. And going back into Stalingrad itself, Soviet propaganda said that Pavlov held his house for 54 days. Others, Glantz and Beaver, say it held for 58 days. And Chuikov says Pavlov held the house for over 50 days while the garrison went without sleep or rest that entire time. Okay, well, it was on this day, the 24th of November 1942, that the garrison of Pavlov's house attacked the nearby milk house. The raid was a failure, and Pavlov was wounded in the fighting. He was carted off on the 25th of November, as was his commander, Naumov. Thus, since Pavlov captured the house on the 25th of September and left it on the 25th of November, he was in it for 61 days, not 50, 54, or 58, but because the propaganda couldn't admit that he got wounded in the fighting, the story had to end before the 61st day, so the 54 days was chosen. Other historians then repeated the 50 plus day idea instead of counting the dates. And what's even more weird about this story is that Pavlov's house actually held out for much longer. Most of the garrison remained, and a new commander, Dragon, yes, the same guy who fought in the Central Railway Station, replaced Naumov as commander of Pavlov's house. And they didn't just hold it for a day or two after Pavlov left. They held it for way longer than that, a couple of months. So, in order to paint the house as Pavlov's house, and not admit that Pavlov himself was wounded and left the house after 61 days, the propaganda significantly reduced the time that Pavlov's house was actually held. And yes, this is a bizarre situation where the myth about the house downplays the heroism of the people involved. Seydlitz ordered most of the pioneer battalions that had been sent into Stalingrad to be disbanded, and they merged into the divisions that they were attached to. He also formally protested to Paulus over the failure to break out.
"The army is faced with a clear either-or situation, either break out to the southwest in the general direction of Kotelnikova, or face destruction in a few days. The OKH order to hold out in hedgehog positions until help arrives is obviously based on false assumptions. It is therefore not feasible and would inevitably lead the army to disaster. Unless the OKH promptly rescinds the order to hold out in the hedgehog position, then my own conscience and responsibility to the army and the German people imposes the imperative duty to seize the freedom of action prevented by the previous order and to use what little time is left to avoid utter disaster by launching our own attack. The complete destruction of 200,000 soldiers and of all their equipment is at stake. There is no other choice."
Notice he keeps saying the OKH, not the Führer specifically. This is perhaps an indication that it wasn't just Hitler who was thinking that the airlift was a good idea at the time. But Seydlitz's concerns were dismissed, not by Paulus or Hitler, but by the Sixth Army's Chief of Staff.
"We don't have to rack the Führer's brain for him, nor does General von Seydlitz have to rack that of the army commander." Meanwhile, back outside the pocket, Hollitt had assumed command of every division on the flank of the Soviet breakthrough, and now ordered the German 62nd and 294th Infantry Divisions to counterattack. The two divisions caught the 14th and 47th Guards Rifle Divisions off guard, and forced them back over the Krivaya River in disorder. The two Kampfgruppen of 48th Panzer Corps also fell back from their pocket and reached the safety of the western bank of the Schur River. But a few hours afterwards, Heim was arrested by the German military police on the orders of the Führer.
"Send for the corps commander at once, tear off his epaulets and throw him into jail. It's all his fault."
Hitler had accused Heim of dereliction of duty in not stopping the Soviet offensive with his mobile reserves. The Führer insisted that Heim had disobeyed Army High Command instructions radioed to him in the field, and thus had failed to attack the enemy at crucial times in the first hours of conflict. Stunned by the charges against him, Heim went home to Germany to face a military tribunal.
In hindsight, Heim's two divisions had no chance of stopping 5th Tank or 21st Armies, yet Heim actually managed to delay Operation Uranus by a day or so, doing more than could have been expected of him. But it's understandable why Hitler, looking to blame someone, blamed Heim. Heim was the most senior commander in the area, so it made sense to blame him, even though it's totally not his fault.
Meanwhile, the Soviets had struck across the Schur and had taken Chernyshevskaya. So, seeing this threat, Hollitt ordered the 48th Panzer Corps to counterattack the Soviet bridgeheads, and with less than 40 tanks, Kampfgruppe Oppeln surprised the Soviet guardsmen and recaptured the town by the mid-afternoon.
3rd Romanian Army was busy forming a line from this area to the Don with whatever ad hoc forces they could gather. Using security troops, supplying construction teams, railroad sentries, and various Luftwaffe personnel and replacements, a large collection of battle groups were created under the various names of their commanders. one group was led by a Wandke. Yes, Wandke. That's a very unfortunate German name. Speaking of names, I know some of you are probably asking, Tik, where's Waldo? Oh, here he is, Kampfgruppe Waldo. And for my British viewers, the American version of Where's Wally is Where's Waldo. And of course the German version is Where's Walter, and the Russian version is Where's Vodka. Both of these battle groups were subordinated to Kampfgruppe Spang. We also have Kampfgruppe Fiebig in the Oblinskaya area, then groups Stumpfeld and Adam plus their subordinate battle groups, and three new Kampfgruppe were also formed in the Nizhnichirskaya area. Group Schmidt, Group Kortner, and Group Zeller. These were all elements of the 14th Panzer Corps' rear services that were outside the pocket. Zeller was the chief of engineering services in the 6th Army, the same guy Anton Jolly showed him speaking in one of his recent videos. Check it out here, and link in the description. Operating against these forces, Butkov's weakened 1st Tank Corps overcame some of the German sentries and captured another village in the area. Fiebig, who was eager to keep the Soviets from overrunning more airfields over the Chur, sent every Stuka and fighter he had against Butkov's tanks. The Red Army Air Force was suffering from a lack of fuel and so didn't offer much resistance, and as a result, Fiebig helped reduce 1st Tank Corps to just 20 tanks by the end of the day. Butkov therefore had to sit on the defence, awaiting much-needed reinforcements.
These came in the form of Czerny's 158th Tank Regiment from the 57th Army. The regiment, and elements of the 60th Mechanized Brigade, were pulled out of the line and sent towards the Don in order to capture the towns of Liepichev and Logovsky. Unfortunately, when they reached Liepichev, they drove straight into a German minefield and Czerny was wounded. His commissar, Sinkovich, replaced him and started fighting Group Schmidt, although made no real progress. The regiment from the Romanian 8th Cavalry Division, plus the remnants of other rifle divisions that had flocked around it, withdrew towards the Kotelnikova region in the wake of the Soviet 4th Cavalry Corps. The units on their right also fell back through the Abilnoi area and moved towards Kotelnikova. And at this point, Hott's 4th Panzer Army was renamed Army Group Hott, even though it was barely an army, let alone an army group. He only had the 6th and 7th Romanian Army Corps, but he was about to receive reinforcements which would, hopefully, justify the upgrade. Colonel Helmut von Panwitz also arrived in Kotelnikova with several thousand volunteer Cossacks. Group Panwitz contained a motorized Romanian artillery battalion and 18 tanks, plus another Romanian battle group was also formed around the 7th Cavalry Division called Group Korn. This was a formidable force that was about to be committed against Shapkin's fatigued cavalry corps, which had outpaced its rifle division support. So there was a potential here for the Axis to regain the initiative. The aim of the game now for the Soviets was to try and destroy the trapped 6th Army, but there were far more men in the pocket than expected, and the Soviet forces were by now exhausted. Pleve's 3rd Guards Cavalry Corps was to advance eastwards with the 51st Guards Rifle Division, however, one of the cavalry divisions was withdrawn to the area southwest of Kalach in case the Germans mounted a relief operation. This move weakened an already depleted force, so when 3rd Guards Cavalry Corps plus supporting rifle divisions dutifully attacked, they only took a minor amount of ground despite the fact that the Germans were withdrawing. A few bridgeheads were seized over the Don, but the 5th Guards and 32nd Cavalry Divisions were halted at Piskovatka by the 16th and 24th Panzer Divisions. Galanin also failed to make much progress, and this failure allowed Strecker to get even more of his forces across the river. Rodin's two remaining tank brigades fielded fewer than 30 working tanks, which wasn't enough to pierce the enemy lines, and Kravchenka also only had around 40 tanks at this stage, so Rodin and Kravchenka were compelled to use their tanks in the infantry support role in cooperation with the 293rd Rifle Division, which had moved up to the front. Rodin, Latugin and Kravchenka therefore advanced together against the 3rd Motorized Division, trying to outflank Marinovka from the north. Rodin moved towards Sokarevka, while Latugin and Kravchenka were halted by the 3rd Motorized Division after Kravchenka's few remaining tanks drove straight into a minefield. The Germans were quickly reinforced by the 14th Panzer Division after it had withdrawn over the Don in the afternoon. And even though Bezzler only had 24 panzers himself, less than half of what he had had on the 19th, this was enough to bring the Soviets to a standstill. The attacks of 57th and 64th Armies had been reduced in scale and scope, simply through exhaustion and stubborn Axis resistance, and so made no ground. Thus, at the end of the 25th of November 1942, Romanenko informed Vatutin that, in the first week of Operation Uranus, his army had advanced 140 kilometers, destroyed the Romanian 9th and 14th Infantry, 7th Cavalry and 1st Armored Divisions, as well as the German 22nd Panzer Division, most of the Romanian 5th Infantry Division, and had done all of this for just 5,315 casualties, 884 of which were dead.
This was a remarkable achievement by any standard. But the battle wasn't over yet. The Axis were beginning to bring up reinforcements, and the Soviets had overrun their logistics and were running out of supplies. Speaking of supplies, the 6th Army was in its pocket, and was now receiving its first shipments by air. So, did the airlift have a chance of succeeding? Let's find out.
It's not clear when Jeseník submitted his initial airlift tonnage calculations, but what is known is that he was comparing his numbers to another airlift that had happened earlier in the year. At Demyansk, 100,000 men had been trapped in a pocket and had successfully been supplied by air for months. Jeseník looked at Demyansk and believed that the Luftwaffe could do the same again at Stalingrad. But was he right? Do the numbers add up? And how does the situation at Stalingrad compare to Demyansk?
Well, at Demyansk, the Luftwaffe was tasked with delivering 300 tons per day into the pocket. The Germans ended up committing almost 500 Ju-52 transport aircraft for the airlift in order to maintain a steady stream of roughly 150 aircraft per day flying supplies. And they averaged 273 tons per day, which apparently doesn't include the fuel and replacements which were shipped in as well. At Stalingrad, the Luftwaffe was tasked with delivering 300 tons per day into the pocket. Yes, the same amount as Demyansk, although some sources say 350, 400, or even 500 tons. But no, both Richthofen and Fieber confirmed that it was 300 tons a day. The difference was that 300 tons to Demyansk would satisfy almost all their needs, whilst 300 tons to Stalingrad would be the absolute bare minimum. Also, the aim was to deliver more than the bare minimum, with Göring saying 500 tons per day was possible. And the 6th Army was also requesting 500 tons per day, which worked out as 200 tons of ammunition and 300 cubic meters of fuel. But hey, if they had almost done it at Demyansk, surely they could do something similar again, right? As Bergstrom points out, during the period from August to the 18th of November 1942, so prior to Operation Uranus, the Luftwaffe had delivered 400 tons per day to Stalingrad. Okay, that was before the weather turned bad, but they had achieved the numbers before, so this airlift was possible. This brings up two questions. One, why were people saying it couldn't be done when it basically had been done before? And two, why did the Luftwaffe end up failing to deliver the goods? They ended up delivering less supplies per day to Stalingrad than to Demyansk, despite using more aircraft. So, why was that? Well, let's start with some basic math. On paper, a Ju-52 could carry 2 tons of cargo, and a He-111 could transport 1.2 tons of cargo. So, just to keep the math simple, if the target is 300 tons, they just needed 150 Ju-52s, or 250 He-111s, or some combination of the two. And when the Demyansk operation started, the Luftwaffe had just 30 Ju-52s immediately available to supply the pocket, while at Stalingrad the Luftwaffe had 291 transports, of which 150 were immediately operational. So straight away, the math adds up. If it required 150 aircraft per day at Demyansk to deliver 273 tons needed there, then surely the 150 operational transports they had immediately available could start to deliver almost the required 300 tons per day at Stalingrad.
In some ways, things were better at Stalingrad than they had been at Demyansk. Bergstrom points out that there was only one airfield at Demyansk, whereas there were at least seven airfields at Stalingrad. Plus, due to better facilities that could handle an airlift operation, the main airfields at Potomnik and Besagina could accept supplies during both the day and the night, unlike the airfield at Demyansk, which could only accept supplies during the day. In addition, there were five smaller airfields at Stalingrad, though all of them were daylight only. Falk does note that Gumrak, Stalingradsky and Karpovka were underdeveloped and dangerous to use, which is why some of the transports crashed when using them. But the point is that there were more and better airfields than there had been at Demyansk. In fact, based on the given numbers, Goering said that 500 tons could be delivered per day. And he was right. With the hundreds of aircraft that were being flown to the area, they could have delivered 500 tons per day on paper. But the raw numbers don't tell the full story. On the 25th of November 1942, Richthofen wrote in his diary, "All of our Junkers are busy supporting the supply, but we only have a little more than 30 of them. Of yesterday's 47 aircraft, 22 were shot down and another 9 today. So we only managed 75 tons instead of the required 300. We are short of transport aircraft."
Well, hold on. They had 291 transports with 150 immediately available to supply the pocket. Yet Richthofen is saying that they only had 47 originally and then 30 after losses. Bearing in mind that other sources give various figures for the planes and the tonnages for these days, but that's not important right now. What matters is that the number of planes was well below the 150 transport aircraft that Bergstrom says were immediately available. So why is this the case? Well, Hayward provides the answer.
Richthofen was not able to deploy all these transport units in support of 6th Army because most still had to carry out vital supply operations for the various Luftwaffe commands they served. This fact, and the fact that all these units were in poor shape, explains why Richthofen was able to commit only 30 of his 295 transport planes to supplying 6th Army on 25th November.
And why were they doing all these other supply operations? Because German logistics was terrible even before Operation Uranus had begun, which not only caused huge shortages of supplies and spare vehicle parts for both the 6th Army and the Luftwaffe, but had also affected them since the summer. 6th Army hadn't been able to stock up on food for the winter, and the men weren't receiving enough food for months. A huge artillery shell shortage had been going on since September, only 40% of the men had received winter clothing, and there was hardly any coal or wood to cook the food that they had received.
In October, instead of the authorised quota of 850 cubic metres of fuel, the army had received an average daily amount of only 456 cubic metres. Further, severe restrictions were announced for November. In order to ensure at least the most necessary operations, consumption by other users had to be cut back to such an extent that repair services, convoys and other supply facilities were largely paralysed.
This might explain why large quantities of broken down panzers were captured in repair shops during Operation Uranus. It also explains why the Germans weren't able to launch large-scale attacks as they had done previously, and had to stop shelling supply ships coming across the Volga at night. Prior to Operation Uranus, Hall notes that the poor food rations were causing jaundice, and when an old member of the 305th Pioneer Battalion returned to his unit on the 26th of October 1942, he was surprised by what he found.
The state of the battalion, but particularly his old first company, shocked him because every officer from France was gone. Hauptmann Traub was a familiar face, but his physique had changed. Months of campaigning and meagre rations had thinned him out.
So even without the airlift, the 6th Army was already struggling to supply itself. and they weren't the only ones. The entire Axis front had gone beyond the point where their logistics could keep up, so the Luftwaffe had to come along to help alleviate the shortages. The problem was that they couldn't just stop supplying themselves or other parts of the front, and so well over 100 of their initial 150 transports were committed to supply operations elsewhere. Thus, Richthofen didn't have enough transports at the start, and would need 200 or 300 additional planes to get the Stalingrad airlift going.
Which is why, within days, another 136 Ju-52s and 54 He-111s plus a load of pilots turned up to support the operation. That's 220 additional aircraft, bringing the total number up to about 511, although losses certainly reduce this. The problem is, of course, that of the 295 original aircraft, only about 30 or 40 were immediately available for Stalingrad. Thus, the additional 220 minus losses meant that Richthofen didn't have 511 transports as Bergstrom assumed, but more likely less than 200.
But even so, on paper, they only needed 150 transports to hit their 300-ton target, and they most likely had that within the first week of the operation, and yet they failed to hit that 300-ton number in this period, so obviously there were more factors at play here. Bergstrom said that a bunch of pilots were transferred to Stalingrad, and while the number isn't stated, this might partly explain why not all the operational transports were going up at the same time. We know later that there was a pilot shortage, but it also appears that this shortage was there from the beginning as well. They had the planes, but not the pilots.
Not only were the transport subunits cleaned out, but the staffs, ministries and training units as well. This was compounded by the Tunisian airlift as well, where 320 Ju-52s would be committed. Had these 320 transports gone to Stalingrad instead, it's likely that they would have hit their target. And there were more differences at Stalingrad than there had been at Demyansk. For starters, Soviet anti-aircraft fire would be a more significant factor, especially since the transport planes would be travelling for longer over Soviet territory. The Red Army Air Force had also been non-existent at Demyansk, whereas now, at Stalingrad, it was a factor, although admittingly unable to go toe-to-toe with the German fighters. Worse, the airfields at Demyansk had been just 60 to 80 kilometers away, while at Stalingrad the distance was 200 to 300 kilometers. Each plane at Demyansk could do multiple trips a day, while those at Stalingrad were capped at 2 deliveries per day at most. It also meant that the planes had to fill up their fuel tanks more at Stalingrad to go the distance, reducing the amount of supplies in each plane by about 25%. So, rather than the 2 tons of cargo a Ju-52 could normally transport, they could only transport 1.5 tons, and the He-111s could only transport 0.9 tons of the maximum 1.2 tons. So, rather than 150 Ju-52s as we calculated before, they would need 200 just to hit the 300-ton number, and 333 to hit the 500-ton number.
Now, some authors have gone further with this and said that because only 40% of the transports were operational in Luftflotte 4, when you crunch the numbers, they actually needed 800 or even 1,050 transports. This being at a time when the Luftwaffe only had 750 Ju-52s in total has led these authors to conclude that the airlift was sheer madness. I will point out though that while only a third of the transports were operational, that problem isn't solved by parking up hundreds of extra aircraft in southern Russia. The transports being sent were operational, otherwise they wouldn't have been able to fly to Stalingrad. So the operational percentage would climb as more transports arrived. It's not a static percentage. They were also sending more pilots, repair crews and spare parts to get the planes operational. So they absolutely didn't need 1,050 aircraft. We can see this on the 7th of December when just 135 aircraft delivered 362 tons to Stalingrad. This also shows that each plane could carry 2.68 tons, or make multiple trips per day, which the 800 or 1,050 figures don't take into account. So these theoretical amounts are well in excess of what was actually needed. They only needed 150 to 200 operational aircraft to deliver the supplies. So, on paper and in reality, this wasn't an impossible task. The numbers actually show that the Luftwaffe could achieve their 300-ton target if they got their act together, something we'll come back to discuss later in the series. But there is a major issue. Delivering 300 tons to Demyansk would fully supply the units there. Delivering 300 tons to Stalingrad wouldn't. In fact, it was the absolute bare minimum they needed, and they couldn't survive indefinitely on that amount. In order to fully supply the 6th Army, they would need 750 tons or more, with SAF saying 946 tons per day, which was absolutely out of the question. The 946 figure was soon revised down to 600, and then the 300 ton figure was eventually selected, but realistically, by only receiving the minimum amount, the 6th Army would suffer in the long term as the airlift dragged on. Thus, the airlift had to be a temporary solution, and Manstein had to get them out within a couple of weeks, which was the plan anyway.
In fairness, one must recognise that neither the dictator nor the Luftwaffe Chief of Staff imagined that the airlift would have to continue for long.
And that is the crucial issue. The airlift was seen as a temporary solution, not a long-term solution, as many have claimed. The intention was to save the 6th Army before it was lost, and the airlift would help it survive until relief came. So, the Germans needed to get their act together, and Manstein needed to attack as soon as he could, regardless whether the airlift worked or not. The question is, could he attack soon, or would it be too late? We'll find out next time. Thanks for watching, bye for now.